at any and all costs.
A survival can. Cool.
Hello everyone, we're taking out the undead today in Resident Evil Umbrella Corps. The only physical edition of the game is in Asia. What's also odd is the fact that it actually has a two-sided cover. Well, one is in English, as you can actually see, and the other side is actually in either Asia, Chinese, Japanese, whatever. Get a disc, you actually get a little booklet. As shocking as that is, not really a whole lot in it, especially since half of it's one language, a completely different language, and a voucher for custom theme and the fashion victim pack, which is just some skin stuff. Being the Asian version, you're the Asian count to claim that if you get the physical version. But the main thing in the game is it really worth even importing the physical version in that regard? It costed me, I think, $35 to get from PlayAsia. And that's probably the trickiest part of this whole thing, is going to be trying to justify paying anything for this game. I actually enjoy this game. I would like to make that clear. I actually am having fun with this game's multiplayer. Single player is a whole different topic. Now, this game's been getting tons of hatred, and not to say much of it is much deserved. This is a very bad game, but I'm getting a very fun B-movie kind of experience out of the game, is what I'm generally getting from it. Now, Umbrella Corps is, again, another attempt to do a multiplayer shooting-type spin-off game that Capcom keeps wanting to fucking do with Resident Evil. And I really liked it, Outbreak, on the PS2. It stuck to Resident Evil's roots while being a team cooperation thing. Admittedly, I did not play a lot of Raccoon City. I played its multiplayer some. The few times I tried the single player, I just found awful. I didn't find anything enjoyable about it. For some reason, I find this really fun, though, online. And it's a very strange arcade feel. It's also because it's what you do in it's just different to me. Because it's not just always a standard kill or that. I mean, there's a few modes in it that are just kinda wouldn't exist in other games very well. Have fun with that. But it's just like a really batshit feel to it. Like, I mean, just crawling on the ground feels strange, but in a funny, hilarious way. You basically have two types of online multiplayer. One, which is multi-mission, where you have multiple objectives, and basically the first team that gets the 3 points wins, and then you start the whole process over. And then there's one life mode, where you are put against another team, and there's no respawning. It's till everyone on the other side is dead. So there isn't a whole lot of variety. But the variety you do get is in the multi-mission, where you gather briefcases within an environment filled with zombies and the opposite team, kill each other in a deathmatch style, find a target on the opposite team, call, kill, collect. You also have DNA mode, where you actually clear and mortal the infected for their DNA. And then there's Special Infected, where you have to find the unique, crazed zombie that will mortal you. So, I mean, they're not like completely original ideas, but there's something different from your standard shooter in a few of them. But I really just find the way it controls interesting. And there's a lot of customization, oddly enough, in this game. It does look horrible, though. This game was made with Unity, and it... I can't say a lot of AAA games have ever had a lot of good luck with Unity. It's really for a much simpler game. But to be honest, though, some of the things are interesting what they were able to do in Unity. But, you know, overall, this game really needed a much better engine for what it was trying to do. Because there's a lot of fucked up shit in it, too. Like, the zombies themselves. They're hazardous to you, but they also act very strange. Sometimes glitchy, or don't even properly react to you. When you attack them the first time of that. It feels kind of glitchy, you know, acting with them. But again, it's very B-movie-ish. I just don't know. There's just something attractive to the game that appeals me. I mean, like, I'm having a snore of a fucking time when it comes to Battleborn. I got that for $29.99 during Amazon Prime. I'm playing that, and I can't get into it at all. There's nothing to me that's fun or enjoyable in the game. So it's kind of weird, especially since when you look at some, like, Metacritic, which I don't ever encourage anyone to look at Metacritic, but it's interesting how this game has such a low score, but I'm having vast fun in it. But this is a tough game to justify money-wise just for the multiplayer alone. It's definitely overpriced for the quality you get. You do not get good quality. I would not walk into this game expecting a perfect, well-balanced... Because it's definitely also not well-balanced there. What's really interesting with the customization, as I was saying, though, is in the online mode, as you get experience towards your weapons and you have a tier system like Call of Duty games where you kill the levels up and get access to a few other things of that. But you also level up your weapons themselves through use, and you get to customize a little about the bullets and the sights, or what I find most interesting. You could put on a lot of different sights on completely different guns. I mean, for fuck's sake, if I want to, I can put a sniper sight on a fucking shotgun. I don't know why you would want to do that, but certainly, there can be interesting, unique ideas you can do with some of the sights with different guns, so there's definitely interesting variety, though. I can't really recall a lot of games that let you do a lot of stuff with the sights, so I thought that was personally an interesting mode. Kaido customizations, not too bad. It's not the greatest thing in the world. It's just a bunch of generic people wearing suits unless you pay some money to get, like, Albert Wesker and other Resident Evil characters unlocked, which, really, to be honest, asking for more money on top of the money to buy this fucking thing is definitely the worst insult in the game, in my opinion. Besides the single player, which is also pretty insulting, to be honest. This game's story in its single player is actually canon with the Resident Evil storyline, which makes me really wonder if they're using it to make a plot point for 7 or something, because it seems odd to set up what's doing. But I'll get on the story itself a little. But I do want to finish up talking about the multiplayer. It is 3-on-3. There was no different sizes or teams in that. And thankfully, the small team size actually does make it a lot easier to find games. Stuff like Battleborn, where it's a much larger group-finding thing. Battleborn has been suffering from the same issue of trying to find fucking people to play with. So the smaller teams actually helps out a lot better with this title, to be honest. Makes the matches a lot faster, too. You won't usually have severely long matches, so it's also definitely a really good game just to sit down to kill a few minutes, and instead of investing, like, you know, Overwatch, for example, it's about, like, 15, 30-minute matches, averagely. You're lucky if you get something under 10 minutes. Like, I mean, just today, this is the shortest fucking match. I'm so glad I got a recording of this, but this was the shortest fucking match was 2 minutes and 40 seconds. Completely devastated the other team. definitely was an interesting moment. But averagely, you're looking between 15 to 30 minute matches a lot of times in a decent, balanced competition in Overwatch. So you got longer matches going in that. So if you're looking for something to kill a few minutes, this is definitely pretty good for that, too. So there's a lot of bizarre ideas in this game. You do have some of the conventional things like sliding and crawling on the ground. Your other arm has a little shield on it you can use when you use your melee weapon or a handgun. You can't use it with your primary weapon, which actually protects your head and upper body more from shots, which is actually a very interesting counter to, say, you see somebody approaching you with a shotgun. You can quickly slip to your handgun and actually defend your face from shotgun rounds while taking the target out. So, there are some interesting ideas in this game. It's just, it really needed a much better engine and team and time invested in it. I think it's pretty easy to see that a small team using Unity tried to put something together. It's a very interesting experimental thing, though. I do enjoy some of the maps, too. Specifically, the mansion. All the maps are reminiscent of places Resident Evil games. There's one from Code Veronica, the mansion. Raccoon City, Lab, which, to be honest, I'm not sure if that's even supposed to be a Pacific laboratory. I mean, there's been a lot of laboratories in multiple games. I mean, we talk about Outbreak, we talk about Code Veronica, there's a lot of laboratories everywhere, you know. There's been a lot of labs. There's the village from Resident Evil 4, the village from Resident Evil 5, so there's a nice, interesting variety of stages from past games in that. So, I definitely like the mansion the most, just probably because of nostalgia, really, though. It's mostly the beginning area with a few of the hallways accessible. I would recommend the game if you see it for a reasonable price, which is, like I said, the hard part. I would definitely not recommend it for its single player unless you're like a really hardcore Resident Evil fan myself. And the thing with the single player is, oh, actually, there is one. You have a jammer device in multiplayer mode. The enemies in the stages, which all of them have enemies, zombies, dogs, and things like that, they will actually ignore you, aside from special zombies. Special zombies will attack you regardlessly, but everything else will ignore you unless your zombie jammer on your back is damaged. If it is damaged, you will be attacked and vulnerable, which is vulnerable, like, strategy you can do if you can snipe someone's jammer across the map or something, and they're basically fucked. I mean, let me tell you, the dog enemies, aside from special zombies, are the most annoying fucking thing in the game when it comes to the zombies. And let me tell you, you get five or more of those fuckers on you, you're just going to die. Unless you got a shotgun or something that's going to save your ass really fast. Because a lot of times they can survive one melee hit half the time, so. But in the single player, you don't have a zombie jammer until the very last few missions. And that makes it a lot harder, and it makes sense why you wouldn't have the zombie jammer, because you're playing by yourself. It's just you and the zombies. So, you know, if you could just weasel through the majority of 99.9% of them, then, you know, there wouldn't be a challenge then. But it does have the odd effect of making someone objectives hard. Basically, you play the multi-mission mode by yourself with the infected with no jammer in the missions in the general story, or just the notes that you get to read before, during the load screen before the game starts, and then you get a finishing message to the fourth note on the select screen after you finish the stage. And that's generally how the story is told through it. The story is you basically are playing a numbered somebody who's given a code number, and you're doing experiments for a bunch of higher up people who are basically watching among the side. Now, this is supposed to take place either after or somewhere close to the end of Resident Evil 6, so, you know, the world's in utter chaos still. Now, you are apparently affiliated with Umbrella still, which Umbrella is technically dead, so it seems like you're playing a bunch of operatives that are basically scrounging together the remains of Umbrella's experiments and stuff. You go through the lab, the Resident Evil 4 village, Resident Evil 5 village, then the police department of Resident Evil 2, and Raccoon City. Now, those last two, you might be like, how the fuck do you go to those? Raccoon City was nuked. The story explains that you got knocked out and you get taken to some kind of recreation of it. And that's about it. I'll go for the story until I go into the spoiler part at the very end of the video. Near the end, you do get a jammer, and the game gets really freaking hard. My biggest problem, probably, with the single player is the special zombies. You're by yourself. Special zombies can kill you, usually in one hit, and if you're lucky, you may be able to survive for a second one. You will get your ass handed to you. So you really have to cheat the fucking game, for the most part, or dodge really efficiently, which, can be tough with the special infected since they fucking move really fast. And that will probably be the common stages you will have the most trouble in, is when there is a special infected. Now, you don't want into any of the special infected until a certain stage in the Resident Evil 4 arc of this storyline. And it gets frustrating, mainly because the fourth set in the lab, you get one objective per level. But in the Resident Evil 4 Village saga part of the stage select, you'll start getting multiple objectives in one level. And the problem is, if you die, you have to start all of them over again. Now, certain maps are made vastly easier, and other ones are a little tougher when you have the special zombies. And here's my two tips to you. If you want to complete the single player mode, the Brainer is your best weapon, which is your melee weapon. And it's a very strange melee weapon. I didn't actually go over that because not a lot of people use it in the multiplayer, but it is an option. It is a melee weapon that looks kind of like a Weeble scythe kind of thing. There's one that looks like an axe. It has a weird heat mode where if it's active when you attack, you can't counter it. You can counter a Brainer if you do a normal melee attack just before you get hit. I haven't had any success doing it myself. You also move a lot faster with the Brainer. So, in the single-player mode, it's really useful to use the Brainer. You move faster, and you want to use the R3 melee, not the R2. The R2 melee is made for player one-hit kills. But aside from special zombies, the R3 melee, which is what you would use with your gun and that to do that kind of melee, will usually kill everything in one hit, with occasional dogs surviving, needing a second hit. So that is one thing I definitely recommend using the majority of time. And another tip is, in any of the stages with special zombies, what you usually will need to do is you need to find somewhere where you can get out of the reach of enemies, which generally most of the stages have somewhere where you can get out of the reach of the enemies, and basically shoot the living crap out of the special infected. And when it's dead, whatever your objective is, get as much of it done, because you'll hear a big echo through the stage when a new special infected respawns, which generally, if they didn't respawn, it probably wouldn't be as bad, but since they respawn infinitely, and your ammo is limited, and there's a few stages where it purposely outright tells you, story-wise, that they're limiting your ammo. And those ones are probably the hardest ones, the ones with special zombies in those. So, you have limited resources and you have to deal with special infected in some of these maps, and it can get really annoying. But once you start learning how to take advantage of your environment against them, you can find ways around it, but it does take some trial and error, and it takes some effort on your part to basically abuse it. It's pretty cheap, and it's pretty unbalanced in single player. Would I recommend Umbrella Corps for you to buy? Unless you're like a really hardcore Resident Evil fan, you're a huge fan, gotta have them all, gotta collect them all, gotta beat them all, gotta know all the story and that. I guess, yeah, don't really have much of a choice, but it's incredibly hard to even justify $10 this game. I am having fun with it. Yeah, keep it up. But it's hard to say that, was it worth the $35 to import from Asia to have a physical version of it? And it has payful customization stuff on top of it. This game feels like a horrible budget game, and that's really the humor in it, in myself. It is different. It does not play like a super normal shooter thing. It is very bizarre, and that's what I enjoy with the really strange clunkiness to it. I'm having fun, but I'd probably say, probably just better to wait to see if it becomes a PlayStation Gold free game if you're PlayStation Plus. Or if you see like a really reasonable cheap deal for it. This is just a tough sell here. It's a tough sell. You have to be a devoted fan of this franchise. I'm having fun, but this would be a much more reasonable game as a free-to-play or some really cheap shelfware, like a $19 shelfware. Because, you know, if you're doing a physical version, I understand you gotta do a little money to pay for the manufacturing fees in there. But, like, considering the Asian version is the only physical version, if you're going digital version, I mean, I could barely justify $10 for this. I'd either wait to hope for it become some PlayStation Gold or a really good deal on it. It's a bad game. It's like, think of it like Bug Island. Didn't I? That's another game that's very not received very well. But there's a fan base for it because it's just some weird, strange, corny B-movie feel to it. And this has that charm. If you know what I'm talking about, you know, a game that a lot of people hate and you just like it because it's really different and it's bizarre and silly. That's what I'm generally trying to say about. It's not refined, it's not balanced very well. It's what it is. This is just something I have to say. If you don't like what you're seeing, then you're probably not going to like it. I saw what I saw, and I pretty much knew I was going to actually enjoy it in a very B-movie way, and I do. This is a simple one, in my opinion. Just go by what you see. But the single player is fucking awful. Anyway, if you have any other questions about this bizarre-ass entry in the Resident Evil series, please feel free to leave a comment down below. From here, we're just going to have a short little bit about the end of the story thing. So, spoilers from here. So, what happens at the end? The end, it doesn't generally completely say in words, but it's believed the character you're playing is Hunk. If you don't know who Hunk is a character that was introduced in Resident Evil 2 in a secret side game you could unlock. Well, he's in the sewers. Hunk was one of the first Umbrella Corps people Umbrella soldiers that went to the scene to recover the virus that the one scientist in 2 was messing around with. Hunk has reappeared in notes, files, and even in some of the games again. It's not exactly explained if assuming this theory that you hunk is true, if, like, while you're in these experiments. It's also believed with a small possibility that Wesker might actually be alive. Now, this is a very debated theory about this in the game. There's a commando character who supposedly has overseen all these scenes, and there's a lot of debate whether it's Wesker or not. Because there aren't a lot of known characters who are aware or overseen all these scenes. Like, for example, for people who think it's not Wesker, have said that Wesker is not officially in the Resident Evil 4 area, and that can be slightly debatable to a certain extent. Because you don't know how far he could be just sitting in some little helicopter or plane or something from the island or anything. You didn't see him personally on the island itself, but that doesn't necessarily mean he wasn't overwatching it. So, I mean, there's a lot of debate about that. Whether I personally think it's Wesker, there's nothing in the game that generally points it to Wesker aside from saying it's... aside from saying that somebody who is familiar with all of these events... So whether Capcom is trying to set up a new character that's just like, oh, I've been behind the scene, or whether they're just going to bring Wesker back, I don't know. The story generally just seems to be setting up a mysterious commander who may or may not be somebody who's always been aware in the game, and that the main character you're playing as is Hunk, referred to as the Grim Reaper by the end of the game. Again, there's nothing in-game that outright says you're Hunk, or whether the or the identity of the commander. And that's generally it. So, hopefully I just saved you a lot of time on the story and money in that regard. Anyway, again, if you have any comments, leave a comment down below, and I will get with you. Thank you for watching, and blaze the zombies.
obtained.
Work, my adorable little lab rat. Your orders are to retrieve all of the briefcases.
Objectives confirmed.
Standing by for data transmission.
Objectives confirmed. Transfer point located. That complicates things.
win this game.